is the way in. Good afternoon. Excellencies, distinguished attendants. My name is Victor Madrigal Borlos. I'm the United Nations Independent Expert on Protection from Violence and Discrimination Based on Sexual Orientation and Gender Identity. Yes, from the States, I should tell you, I would have a lot of time to do very useful things with my life if my title were shorter. So please, next time. It's such an honor to be here with you today. We are here because lesbian, gay, bisexual, trans, and gender persons and other queer persons around the world have long been the object of violence and discrimination. I've been honored to facilitate the proceedings today and the first let's hope that we are all together up to the task. I will so thank you for your cooperation in this regard. It is now my great honor to invite the Deputy Prime Minister of the Netherlands, Wopke Hoekstra, to the podium to deliver remarks.
Your Excellencies, esteemed colleagues, dear friends, it is fantastic to see all of you here today. And a special welcome to our new friends who have joined since last year. Peru, Belgium, Timor-Leste, Portugal, the Dominican Republic, and Finland. We are now with 43 members. And this is tremendously important because we are here today to honor a truly fundamental human right, the right to be yourself and the right to express yourself, to love who you want to love without the fear of persecution, discrimination, or stigma, to participate in society to the fullest and not be left behind. And to many of us, this might seem a right that is completely self-evident. But to many others, unfortunately, it isn't. And the bad news is, dear friends, the bad news is that we are fighting an uphill battle for equal rights globally. Our human rights architecture and multilateral system is under attack. It is being challenged by rising authoritarianism and movements seeking to undermine democracy itself. International political support for human rights is unfortunately declining. We need to make sure, we as a group need to make sure that our human rights system survives. How can we do this? Well, intellectually, it is actually not that difficult. We can and should do so by empowering those who work day and night to keep it alive. LGBTI human rights defenders are often at the forefront, at the very forefront of this particular struggle. And it is because of their brave activism and visibility that LGBTI communities are often the first targets of forces that want to undermine human rights itself. They, you, can count on our unwavering support. The Kingdom of the Netherlands stands with you, in words and in deed. That's why we are the largest government donor to the LGBTI community and causes worldwide. And we will continue to defend equal rights to everyone and to work towards more participation of the LGBTI community in all spheres of public life. Because societies are more innovative, more resilient, and simply more creative when all voices are heard. And also because I am sure that we all acknowledge the eternal truth in a beautiful aphorism: none of us are free until all of us are free. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much to the Deputy Prime Minister Hoekstra. And now it is my honor to invite His Excellency Santiago Cafiero, Minister of Foreign Affairs, International Trade and Worship of Argentina.
Gracias. Dear colleagues, Good afternoon, everyone. The United Nations LGBTI core group is a multilateral importance for the development of policies and projects with a gender perspective. We are honored to have co-chaired the group with the Netherlands since 2016. This reflects our commitment to the rights of LGBTIQ plus persons around the world who suffer from discrimination and exclusion in every aspect of public life, including in education, healthcare, participation in politics, among many others. Therefore, the work of this group is crucial to promoting and guaranteeing universal respect for their human rights and to the promotion of the protection of these rights. We have a strong regulatory framework that includes the Marriage Equality Act, the Gender Identity Act, and the Trans Labor Quota Act, and the creation of the Argentine Ministry of Women, Gender, and Diversity in 2019. This year, President Alberto Fernandez appointed a special representative on sexual orientation and gender identity. Prestigious leader, she have a friend here? So prestigious leader, yeah, there. Prestigious leader, an activist ambassador, Alba Rueda, which reflects the important place of diversity on Argentina's international agenda. Since 2019, Argentina and the United Kingdom have co-chaired the Equal Rights Coalition, which is made up of 42 countries that work together with over 140 civil society organizations. Early this month, Argentina hosted the conference of the coalition in Buenos Aires, and participants agreed that we need to focus our efforts on the fight against violence and discrimination, especially in a global context where hate speech and anti-gender movements seek to erode the expansion of the human rights of all persons. To conclude, I wish to stress that Argentina is fully committed to further advancing the recognition and expansion of the rights of lesbian, gay, bisexual, transgender, and intersex persons. Our countries co-chair in the United Nations reflects the leadership and commitment of Argentina to leave no one behind, consistent with the 2030 agenda, and to continue working for more just and inclusive society where all persons, without exception, have full enjoyment of their human rights. These commitments drive us to continue joining forces to develop a diverse, more just, and more inclusive foreign policy. Thank you for being here. Thank you very much.
I'm very thankful for those opening remarks. The reason that we are here today is that precisely participation is at the core of what we know as the human rights-based approach. Non-discrimination, empowerment, and accountability surround this pillar in which people are heard. And the reason why they are heard is because fundamental decisions of public policy matter to them and to their everyday. We have the honor of two keynote speeches today. I will now have the honor of inviting to the podium Her Excellency Katrin Jakobsdottir, the Prime Minister of Iceland. Prime Minister, you have the podium.
Dear colleagues, dear friends, dear guests, it's a real honor and privilege to be here with you at this very important event. Iceland is delighted to have become a member of the core group in 2020 along with Nepal. And I will not tire to say that multilateral cooperation is essential when we're talking about human rights and democracy it is so important, at least for small countries, to participate on this level. Now, I'm going to tell you maybe three lessons from Iceland on LGBTI rights. When I became Prime Minister 5 years ago, shortly after that, I moved the equality portfolio, including LGBTI issues, from the Ministry of Welfare to my office, the Prime Minister's office, where I created a new Department of Equality in the beginning of 2019. And why did I do that? I did that because I'm a very strong believer that political policies, they can actually have a great effect on our societies, but it also, to speed up that process, it's very important to have decision taken at the top layer. Policies can bring forth very important change in how we do things, and those practical steps can actually change and even transform cultures and attitudes. And sometimes we see political policies coming first and then a change of culture and attitudes. I've seen that happen when it comes to gender equality in Iceland, where we actually implemented the legislation on shared parental leave first, and then we saw the culture and attitudes change. Now, for the past 5 years, my government, and this is another lesson, has actually made a very significant progress in advancing LGBTI rights in Iceland. When it comes to legislation, we have put in place laws on gender autonomy, anti-discrimination. Our parliament has adopted the first national action plan on LGBTI rights of its kind in Iceland. And our new gender autonomy law actually allows people to register their gender without any requirements or restrictions. There's also a gender neutral option. We have put more effort into fighting hate crime and hate speech. A bill was adopted this spring amending the General Penal Code to include a provision on hate crime and hate speech, protecting groups including people with disabilities and intersex persons. So what's the lesson learned? Yes, we have made this amazing. We have seen amazing things happen when it comes to policy making, but still, even in Iceland, we see a backlash when it comes to LGBTI groups. So it's not enough just to have the legislation. We must do all we can to safeguard social acceptance, and these aspects must actually go hand in hand if we want to see true change. And I think true change will happen. I think the politics must lead the way in that. Third lesson, and then I come back to the multilateral cooperation. Human rights is actually a cornerstone of Iceland's foreign policy and an international and also international development cooperation. And in this decade of action and SDGs, with the aim of building peaceful, just and inclusive societies, the advancement of equal rights for LGBTI people must be included. Leave no one behind should mean really leave no one behind. Together with the other Nordic countries, we're also working on a roadmap for advancing gender equality and equal rights for LGBTI persons. And during our upcoming chairmanship of the Council of Europe, Iceland will place LGBTI rights at the forefront. As part of this, we will host the 10th European Idahot Plus Forum in Reykjavik next year. At the UN, we work with this core group on inclusive language in resolution and texts. This is also something that we've been working on in Iceland, in Icelandic. And is always, it sometimes becomes a very heated debate, but it has also been a very good lesson to learn for all of us. We have also supported the UN Free and Equal Initiative with regular contributions. The Equal Rights Coalition is an important forum bringing together governments and civil society organizations. And Iceland has recently doubled its annual contribution to the Global Equality Fund, GEF, which is hosted by the US State Department. And therefore, it's a true pleasure to be here with you today, Secretary Blinken. We have worked closely with the State Department under your leadership, and we look forward to hosting the next GEF meeting in Iceland in the first week of October. But what is the lesson learned from this? That change cannot just happen in one place in the world. We need to see it spread around, and therefore, multilateral cooperation is of such importance, not just for small countries, but for all countries, but not least for smaller countries like Iceland, who really rely on that we respect the rules we have actually made together and agreed upon. It is essential for all of us, and when we're talking about human rights, these rules are really an issue of life and death, and really allowing people to be who they want to be. Dear guests, to conclude, our ongoing dialogue about the rights and well-being of LGBTI people is hugely important. And we must continue to educate, listen, and always speak up. And maybe that's the toughest bit, not just to stay silent, but always speak up, always stop when something like that happened. In your home, at your workplace, but also here, also at the UN, wherever we go, because the same rules really apply in the big global arena and at home. And we're all part of this effort, because the fight for equality is not to be left to those within the LGBTI community only. It is of great importance and benefit to all of us that society is equal and accepting everyone, and we must all participate in making this a reality. Thank you so much.
I honor to offer the podium to His Excellency, Secretary Antony Blinken, Secretary of State of the United States of America.
Well, thank you. Good afternoon, everyone. And look at this turnout. It's wonderful to see all of you here. It's wonderful to be part of an incredibly powerful and growing coalition, as evidenced just by my three colleagues and friends who've spoken. To my friends from the Netherlands and Argentina, Wilke, Santiago, thank you for your leadership. Thank you for your engagement. And let me say as well, I think we've just heard the powerful words from the Prime Minister. It's wonderful to see you. Wonderful to be with you in this effort. To all the other partners present, we're grateful for the sustained work to champion LGBTQI plus rights. We're meeting at a time when the movement for equality is showing some encouraging momentum. A few examples. This summer, St. Kitts and Nevis and Antigua and Barbuda became the latest governments to decriminalize homosexual acts. A month ago, the government of Vietnam announced that homosexuality, bisexuality, and transgender identity cannot be considered illnesses, and that LGBTQI plus people cannot be subjected to so-called conversion therapy. At the same time, for that progress, which is real and which is worth underscoring, we know that people worldwide continue to experience alarming levels of violence, discrimination, isolation. Risks are the highest for people with disabilities, people of color, refugees, and LGBTI plus women. Transgender people are often denied access to legal identity documents that reflect their names and gender markers. Intersex people, including minors, continue to be subjected to unnecessary surgeries without their consent. All countries, including those of us in the core group, have work to do to ensure that LGBTI plus people have the same rights, the same protections as all other people. Defending these rights is central to the health of our democracies. Any system where some groups are treated as less than simply because of who they are is fundamentally flawed. Standing up for LGBTI plus people is a top priority for our administration. A month after taking office, President Biden took action to promote LGBTI plus rights in our diplomacy. Last September, he appointed an extraordinary person, Jessica Stern, as our new special envoy to advance the human rights of LGBTI plus persons. Anyone who's worked with Jessica knows you don't want to be on the other side of an issue. Big mistake. This summer, the President issued an executive order to advance equality for LGBTI plus people, including by combating so-called conversion therapy, supporting LGBTI plus children and families, protecting health care and programs to prevent youth suicide. Everything we're doing builds on the work of literally generations of advocates who have and still are risking so much to put LGBTI plus people and their rights on the map. And I have to say, as I read the history, learn the history, hear of experiences, I'm quite in awe of generations of advocates who have done so much to put us where we are today. The work we're doing is only possible because of the work they did, but not only the work they did, the courage that they showed. There's so many people that one could point to, but I want to just single out a couple of people. And I think they're here today. People like Liberty Montaisa, who is here from South Africa. Are you here?
To your left.
Right there. Thank you. A champion for the rights of trans and gender diverse people. Thank you for being with us. And people like the individuals who decided to stand up to the routine and harassment and discrimination that they've endured at the hands of police at a gay bar not very far from where we meet today. The 1969 protest at the Stonewall Inn marked a turning point in our nation's struggle for LGBTI plus rights and helped galvanize the global movement. This is something that is seared into the memories, seared into the consciousness of so many of us. And particularly for me as a native New Yorker, it's something that I have seen and been inspired by for many, many years. Stonewall is also a stark reminder of all the places worldwide where people are still subject to abuse simply for being themselves. That's why this group's work is as important as ever, maybe more important than ever. It's why we are so proud and determined to be your partners every single step along the way. Thanks to all of you for everything that you're doing, that we're doing together. Thank you.
Thank you very much to Secretary Blinken, and we do have